All right, welcome to our episode on Hellhammer as a preliminary to our Celtic Frost special coming next week. Now, Hellhammer was a band started by Tom G. Warrior from Switzerland, and it's characterized by a very hardcore punk approach to metal, I'd say. It's very simple. Some would say dumbed down. I would say it's just savage. It reduces everything to riffs. And what's important about it is how it leads up to Celtic Frost. So, Cullen, you have some impressions about this birth of Celtic Frost.
The best way I could summarize Hellhammer is if music and sound itself could just be completely drunk, completely wasted, that's basically what Hellhammer is. Like it's like, it's stumbling around, the bass drum is all over the place, the tempos are just abruptly changing, it's slurring, like the guitar is completely out of tune, which in my opinion really benefits the sound. It's almost like he's puking the vocals out. Like it's just a complete mess of a sound. I think the intent was to mimic Venom, but there wasn't really much of an attempt to keep up with Venom's speed. It was more just like, all right, without trying to just match that, like really, really, really hyper fast thrash metal scene, speed. They decided to just like, let's just make this as ugly as humanly possible, you know?
What about its influences? Because I hear we talked about this before. We hear a little bit of these hardcore punk influence, and we also hear I hear a little bit of doom metal in some parts because it really slows things down. So it has the thrash side with its rock and rolly, sometimes rock and rolly riffs, and then it has the doom side, right? And the punk.
Absolutely. I've heard everything here from Black Sabbath to the Misfits to Judas Priest. Classic heavy metal parts. There's really slow doom parts. There's hardcore punk. There's even almost like psychobilly like type of stuff. It's really all over the place. Like it's pretty much everything that we've heard from extreme music up until that time, kind of thrown together in this way that really works. It's impressive how they took all these different sounds and created its own unique, weird sound out of everything.
About it that way, about it all being whatever was before in the underground side of metal, right? And then how they reinvent everything for Celtic Frost, where we when in Celtic Frost we don't see like everything's all over the place. We actually see a compressed monolithic style. Nick,
It lost a lot of the really experimental stuff that was on the demos, and I thought that was something really fun to dive into. I was really impressed how many songs they had that were just very unique to these demos, and just all of the energy and the excitement and the different ideas that were on these songs. Like it was really impressive to me.
What are your impressions of Hellhammer?
I
Oh
think
man.
the Angel Witch, Angel of Death riff was insanely influential on the band. I don't know if you've heard that riff. It's just a very simple, slow, and chromatic riff, and like just that one riff, I think they did a lot with it. And I know for a fact that Tom G. Warrior is a huge Angel Witch fan. I think there's that. I think a lot of Motorhead that comes out through the music and everything. I think that's what they were trying to copy aesthetics wise. And just a lot of stuff. I remember he did say that he heard a Discharge's Hear Nothing, See Nothing, Say Nothing. And that kind of like, he was not really into punk, but that album just opened up so many pathways for this music.
The Discharge in particular, I think that's what it reminded me of too. Not like punk in general, although Cullen mentioned Misfits. What about the Misfits in particular, would you say?
Some of these riffs are very much in the style of the Misfits. The drumming is very, very Discharge. I think that's the most Discharge influence is in the drums. You have D beats all over the place, very punk rock drums. This is before like the blast beat really came around, so that was kind of his best way to keep that tempo and that you know, the feel. Yeah, I don't know. There were certain riffs, or I was just thinking this could be a Misfits song. You know, even the vocals a little bit to some extent too. Yeah, I mean Motorhead. That's another big one in this music. That was probably the most extreme stuff before Venom. So. This was just kind of pushing that like to the next level with like the way the riffs are put together. You know, you have these riffs where it's like every single note next to each other on the fretboard, basically. You know,
yeah.
You hear a riff and it's starting to sound like it's some kind of key or some kind of mode, and then all of a sudden it'll just go a half step lower than you were expecting or a half step higher than you. Like it's just this really ugly, like offensive sound. A lot of people were really, really, really offended by these recordings that they were sending around to these magazines. They were almost like disgusted. Like, how could you send this stuff and call it music? You know, the very music itself was just just took everything that was convention at the time and just tore it up. Like,
I think you mentioned that. One of you mentioned in our preliminary conversation for this podcast that only H.G., what's his name? I forget his initials, Giger, right?
Yeah.
The artist. How do you pronounce his name?
Yeah,
H.R.
Yeah, H.R. Giger, Giger, right? Yeah.
Uh-huh. I'm really impressed that they even sent these things to him because he was already an established artist. He had done Alien and everything already. Why would they think about sending it to him? And it's very... telling, I think he actually accepted it, right? Somehow it meshes well with his art.
That's an interesting story. I read that they when they recorded these demos, they actually hated how it turned out. The band itself was just like, oh no, this is terrible. But they were like, okay, we'll just send this out anyway. And they got a lot of crap for sending these demos around. And that caused them a lot of problems throughout their career, even after they switched to Celtic Frost. But a lot of people, it resonated. It really captured something in the human spirit, I think, you know, that people could really relate to it. And I think a lot of times this terrible production, the attitude, the sloppiness, I think it really worked in the favor of what they were trying to ultimately convey.
Look at early Napalm Death. It was a sensation in a way. I mean, not a huge sensation in the world, but I mean, it ruptured the whole scene. And I think the first Napalm Death is much more of a savage, disorderly attack than Hellhammer is. I think Hellhammer is a lot more orderly than Napalm Death.
It's more noise, I would say, the early Napalm Death. It was closer to just this random noise, which Hellhammer is to some extent, but those early Napalm Death, yeah, people thought that was just a complete joke at first.
It was. I think at first they meant it as a joke. I'm not sure.
Oh yeah.
I mean, they were making statements. It was more like a performance art because they were leftists, I think, and they were big into doing statements with their, yeah. You mentioned Venom and Motorhead, right, as the biggest influences or noticeable. Which one of the two would you say is more extreme? I think you were pointing to Venom. Why would you say Venom is the more extreme of them?
I'm just going based on the interviews. I dug up some old interviews, and Tom Warrior was saying himself that they literally wanted to copy Venom. That's where the image came from. To some extent, that's where the lyrical themes came from. But it also seemed... the lyrics seem to have a really personal element to them too. And I think the issue with, he said in the interviews that they were just a Venom clone, or they were trying to be a Venom clone. But when you listen to it, I really wouldn't
yeah.
call it, because again, they couldn't keep up with the speed. They threw in all this. Venom's very clean, very polished, you know, like the songs are very structured. It's, you know, faster and more aggressive and, more edgy than what we've seen at the time, But it's still almost like you said, I think you called it party rock at some point or party metal. And I think to some extent it still has that vibe from Judas Priest and that type of stuff, where Hellhammer is just pure ugliness. It's just gross.
Nicholas, you mentioned Angel Witch, right? I was surprised by that. I did not see that one. Where can you hear it in Hellhammer, would you think?
You know, people forget, like, Angel Witch's first album and the demo was actually quite varied in terms of sounds. And it has the one song, you know, Angel of Death. If you listen to it, it's a very slow-paced and very chromatic song. It's like Black Sabbath, a simpler version of what Black Sabbath were doing around, like, you know, Masters of the Universe and Volume 4. And it was very, in that, you know, it's literally just... The riff was like four chromatic notes, you know, da 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 da, just very simple. And I think that was insanely influential for Hellhammer, because you know, on the first demo, Death Fiend, you can tell that they're really struggling to get out of the kind of rock and roll mindset. You know, they still have a lot of those kind of very you know, Chuck Berry kind of chugging riffs, you know, da 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 kind of stuff, and they're still trying to find their own kind of language.
I was wondering, with every wave of innovation in metal, there's always the next people in line who say that the people before them had it easier because everything, maybe things hadn't been done until that point. I was wondering if the rise of the internet somehow crippled creativity in metal, because you're saying, Cullen was saying, that Hellhammer was trying to be a Venom copy, right? A clone. And as you say, they don't sound anything like them. And it's not only, apart from the fact that they maybe couldn't keep up with the speed of Venom, they were adding other stuff in there, and they ended up producing something different. Whereas today, I don't know if because it's so easy for us to listen to so much music all of the time, then our minds don't have the space. And I don't know what other psychological processes there are involved, but it's like after the year 2000, it's a lot harder to see anybody doing something new. And I really don't think it's because everything has been done, because everybody thinks that all the time. Even 300 years ago, everybody was saying that. So,
and that's interesting. I spent a lot of time thinking about that, to be honest. I came around as a musician around 2001, 2002 is when I got started. And I had this impression, like, you know, being the first of that internet age, like, oh man, like the musicians of my generation, they're going to be the next level because we have access to all this music. It's so easy to get to it. We're going to have like a whole encyclopedia in our heads. But you're right. I think the issue is that, like, you know, say I discover a band, like say I discover Venom, I could click on, you know, I could just click on a link, like what else, or Google just what else sounds like Venom, get 10 other bands that sound exactly like Venom. And then like, okay, I'm going to stick to this exact formulaic, structure here. And yeah, I think that's really hampering musicians in the big scheme of things, is that like, oh, they're like, okay, we want to be this like particular micro genre. Here's a bunch of artists in this micro genre. Okay, these are the rules. Here's how we're doing it. Whereas like, you know, when these Hellhammer demos got out, I think of all the different bands. You had like Possess, you had like Sepultura, you had the bands that were inspired by these had just completely unique and different sounds. Mayhem, you know, like you look at Mayhem and Sepultura, like they're totally different sounds, but they both came out of this like Hellhammer prototype. And yeah, I think it was more beneficial to have, you know, where you hear something like you want to jump on board with that, but you don't have this whole template, you don't have this whole you know, pre-existing structure to jump into.
See, I think I would say you don't see, or you shouldn't see, for example, writers like novel writers or fiction writers just getting a template of what exactly the older writer is doing and then just copy pasting it and changing the names, which is what I think people in metal are doing all of the time, right?
Yeah.
The very strict template. It's
Yeah. And to some extent, I think that's also what people are looking for. I think the consumer base in metal now seems to be s get stuck in these micro genres and say like, I want this, and they're not really interested in bands like, stumbling outside of that. And I don't understand the really the psychology of that. I don't know if it's just like if it's just this desire to fit in and be like, oh yeah, I know this genre, so I'm just gonna stick to like what is exactly within those, parameters. Yeah, I think about that a lot. I don't get it really.
Although that's exactly what you described happening to Hellhammer at the beginning, right? Nobody wanted them, right?
Yeah,
It was just with
exactly.
time, a few people got it and they started to play with it. And so everybody was pointing back at Hellhammer and saying,
Yeah.
we did it because of them. So that's how
Yeah.
Hellhammer got famous.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And I just think of it, all the, bands that these releases really influenced and really took the way those bands took off, it's just incredible that like these, these goofy little like low quality demos would spawn like such a phenomenon. And you have Mayhem, they go and they start black metal, like Possessed and Sepultura, like they lay the foundation for death metal, and you have these like entire genres spiraling out of this stuff. And these genres develop far, far away from a lot of this. There's a lot of stuff here that I don't think was retained. Like the D beats, they were out of black metal and death metal like not long after that. A lot of these weird doom like experimental passages, those were filtered out eventually. But yeah, they really made a huge impact with where all these different metal genres were going from here, even without and still retaining like so many elements of their sound that just were never replicated again.
Specifically, I want to go into our favorite songs to be able to illustrate some of these points. And in my case, I really, really like Buried and Forgotten. I like the fact that it has very fast section and then a very slow, it starts up slow, right? With that, it starts out with three Latin words, like invoking Satan or something like that. And it's very slow. It's like dun, 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 right? And then he alternated with something that's faster. And I really think this creates a very interesting vibe because the slower section gives it gravity and then the faster one gives it aggression, right?
Yeah.
So that's my favorite one. What about Nick? Do you have a favorite track?
It's funny. I remember that song. What I love about it, it literally starts off with, after that Latin part, starts off the words necromantical screams, which was one of the Celtic Frost song on it's the
The
last
end of
song on Two
into the
Mega Therion.
pandemonium.
Yeah, no, Two Mega Therion is the last song.
Very right. Yes,
Yeah.
yeah.
But yeah, in terms of songs, I think I'm gonna have to go with Satanic Rites as being this band's kind of like magnum opus, in that I don't really consider it a demo. I really can. It's a full length. It's about 45, maybe 50 minutes long. I think it's very fully developed. I'm gonna have to go with a very either Triumph of Death or Messiah, because Messiah is definitely the black thrash riff on the, in the entire discography for so many reasons.
The most, that's what they're remembered for, I think. That's what people want to play. People who know Hellhammer, the few people. I don't know how many people actually listen to Hellhammer. What about you, Cullen? What
For me,
song?
it's Triumph of Death by far. I mean, I feel like the vocals alone in that were just so groundbreaking. It was just this incredibly primal, like, and again, this song is on multiple releases, so you have totally different versions of it. It's never the same thing twice. But yeah, the vocals were just this like just this raw, primal, primitive masculinity, like all these crazy noises and grunts. And this vocal style ended up being like the style for certain bands like later on. Like it was kind of a departure from the traditional Celtic Frost, or the traditional Hellhammer vocals. But yeah, I mean, like, he just really just completely lets loose. The song is just all over the place. Like, there, it's got this, you know, for just having three instruments, like just for, you know, or drums, a bass, and just one guitar, it sounds to me like one guitar. They really created like a great atmosphere with that track, just using those minimalistic instruments. I mean, they really just create this whole complete vibe that it would take, like, you know, if that were to be replicated, I would usually hear with a lot of keyboards and a lot of like layers and stuff, but just with those three instruments, they really just made this audio masterpiece that that's just so classic.
And you know, for me, a lot of what they are able to do here with only three instruments is because the music has a lot of space. You know, sometimes you were pointing out that the guitars sometimes will do weird changes, that the drums are kind of all over the place. But sometimes that disconnect between the guitar and the drums means that they're in different places. And all of this space between them that you sense in your mind, like they're not in the same place, or they're covering a wider world, let's say. I think that gives it more life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, Mick.
I mean, it's also funny that the way they repeat these riffs, then they're not, I don't think they're physically capable, well, back then at least, of playing a riff twice the same way. Because, you know, the Satanic Rites version of Triumph of Death and the Apocalyptic Raids version of Triumph of Death are completely different. You know, and even though I think they just stick to the main ideas, the best ideas, because maybe they weren't capable of doing anything else. And then they just play with that so well, you know, where it's you have the best riffs and you kind of keep them over the years throughout all the evolutions of these songs. And so ultimately, you know, despite still being within us somewhat, I would say, you know, the language of the bands that they were listening to, they were still able to be so forward thinking at the same time, because they were trying to do their like their own thing, completely chromatic within those rock and roll confines.
What you said about not playing the song two times the same in the same way, or recording it the same way, in a way, by doing that, and I think it's a very important observation you made, they are able to keep the work alive, if you will, in a different way. And we know another musician who does that. He does it on purpose, and this is the guy from Abyssum, Rex Eveleb. He does that, and he says he will approach a song again and again while he can keep playing it differently. Like if he can play, and when he feels it's done, he will not touch it again, but he will approach it in many different ways until he gets everything he can after the from the riffs. So and the result is very interesting. Do you feel like when they became Celtic Frost and they got all of these ideas about what professional music was, they started to, what's the word, calcify?
Definitely. But then they never did, because I think what happened on with Hellhammer just gave them, you know, such a great ability to change and to evolve. Sure, you know, certain aspects were a lot tighter in Celtic Frost sound, but then again, a lot of the aesthetics present here were in many ways refined on Celtic Frost, you know, depending how you want to see it, you know, professionalized at the very least. But they were never a static band. I don't think, you know, the main two guys here, Anon and Celtic Frost, you know, Tom Jewery and Martin Eric Lane, they were constantly evolving. You know, there are no two identical Celtic Frost records.
True. That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think Celtic Frost in Two Megatherion, it's still preserving the howls, right? I think that still has, and I like that a lot. It's very different as well. That's a very difficult album to digest, I feel, in spite of the fact that it's sort of basic for extreme metal. Like you don't just sit down and listen to that album peacefully at in one go. Now we want to go over all of the demos to explore how Hellhammer evolved from one to the other. The first of the demos is Death Fiend. By the way, all of these three demos came out in 1983, which is impressive in its own, because the band was formed in 1982, and from 1982 to 1983, they were managed to put together, I don't know, like 20 songs, is it? How much? How many songs?
I think it's more like 25, 26 original songs, man, overall. Even more, probably. Close to 30 within that demo period.
They only selected four.
Yeah.
Or six, was it, for the EP?
The Apocalyptic Raids. Yeah,
Apocalyptic Raids was originally four songs.
Yep. For the expanded version.
I would assume that's probably the financial,
Yeah. I mean, it's short because it did come out on a 12-inch vinyl of Apocalyptic Raids, and it's only 20 minutes. So, two songs aside.
Some serious pleasure.
So, Death Fiend, the first of the demos. First impressions of it?
This one it's completely jumbled in so many ways. I think it's got a lot of potential, but it's not one I come back to the most, because I think it's where you really see where they're coming from, the ideas they had. They're really kind of expressing their influences, even though, you know, the basis of their style is there. It's very jumbled and confused. Their voice isn't quite as strong here.
And it's very savage from the very beginning. It reminds me of the energy on Death Crush, on Mayhem's Death Crush. It's very noisy. And
well, the first song is called Maniac, who was the singer on Death Crush.
It has this title that really pops out, Bloody Pussies. It's a ridiculous title. Yeah. And it's a kind of an interesting song. Well, not interesting, but it also has that thing I mentioned before, where they switch between fast, very fast riffs and very, very slow riffs. So they're doing that from the beginning already, from the get-go. Other than what's
a good start, I would say overall, I consider, in my opinion, that yeah, every demo was better than the one before it. I still think this is a pretty good start. It's not completely unlistenable. It's got all the elements here. Even the songs carried on for the next couple of demos. I think this was a decent, or even I would even say really good first demo.
No, definitely.
They have this song called Chainsaw. They have this.
That's one of my favorites. It's just so raw and ugly, you know.
I mean, I'm not extremely familiar with Venom. So their titles, do they have anything that's like this, like murder oriented, like ready for slaughter?
No, Venom was really kind of pentagrams, Sabbath, witches, kind of imagery, very tongue-in-cheek occult.
Yeah, drug use, angel dust use. It was more, it still had more Venom. The way I would just differentiate the lyrics and the song titles, and I guess to some extent the aesthetics, is Venom was still, it still very much had like the rock and roll vibe, Like, it was a kind of like, you know, like almost campy and almost goofy. Like, Hellhammer, I feel like, is really, really tortured, like really serious and cruel and grotesque. I mean, the lyrical themes on these demos, I've seen it, there's infanticide, there's genital mutilation, there's, you know, like it really pushed it to the next level, like just really, really ugly stuff. Very, very different tone than Venom.
I was wondering about their influence, but let's finish with the demos first. So that's Death Fiend, then we have Triumph of Death. What changed from Death Fiend to Triumph of Death?
I think their influences got a lot weaker here, and that they weren't looking to, you know, they had their own reference point and they were looking to expand on that. And then, you know, you obviously you have the first version of Triumph of Death here. You know, some great, great songs, which really do encapsulate a lot of the kind of, a lot of the Latin American savagery, even the early Mayhem stuff, you know, songs like Decapitator here, or, you know, Reaper, which really showcased the band kind of, well, you know, this, it's really easy to say that this was in many ways, like probably the beginning of war metal, the kind of black, very aggressive black metal really begins here, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely.
At some point, we're going to have to discuss ultra metal, right?
Yep.
After this, and it has some relation to this, especially because I think time-wise, on the timeline, it's parallel to Hellhammer. It doesn't, how much of ultra metal actually comes after Hellhammer? I mean, how fast were tapes getting from, trading tapes getting from Switzerland all the way to Colombia? That's my question.
Probably a right? Matter of months, if not weeks.
I think so. Mm-hmm. Because the early stuff from Parabellum, for instance, the early stuff is what, 1984, 1983, even, as far as they claim, at least.
Yeah.
And it's, some of it is even wilder than this. More easy.
Definitely.
Right, so Death Fiend still getting their own ideas together, and you hear the influence of other bands still encroaching upon their sound. Then we have Triumph of Death coming out a bit more originally, and then our third demo, Satanic Rites, which came out, by the way, on the last day of 1983, December 31st,
Jesus Christ.
1983.
Yeah. I mean, for me, this is perfection.
Good year.
Yeah. This is the perfection in their style, this one. Like, if there ever was a kind of, you know, an album or CD or whatever within that one specific kind of sub-style they innovated, this has to be it for me. You know, everything's is perfect. You know, their intents are perfectly clear. I think they figured out that they could do really a lot with some of the stupidest riffs I've ever heard, but they work so well. You know, literally, I'm talking about two-note riffs, you know, where the second note is only used to create some, you know, a bit of tension between them both. And then this is where you can make a case that the kind of, you know, standard second wave kind of, you know, the tremolo picked riff, the idea of tremolo picking power chords at that speed probably came from here, because this is where they really kind of, it's not that it was faster, but it, you know, the pace was still consistent, but they were hitting the strings faster, if that makes sense. Instead of doing it in eighth notes, they were in 16th notes, even though the pace is slow. And while those riffs are really simple, you know, it's just going up and down the neck, or, you know, if you skip a note, go back to a note, like we, you know, Cullen said, when we were speaking about this album last week. But yeah, I think this is it. This is really where it fully, you know, this is a statement in extreme metal, in underground metal at the time.
You know, Satanic Rites, the demo, it reminds me a lot of the energy in that the Grotesque compilation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bit messy, and a bit all over the place, but it's very free in a way, right? Very energetic. The manly energy that Cullen pointed out, I think. I mean, it's a little bit unbridled. I mean, I can imagine how the creative process for this must have been, right? They probably PUBG Warrior might have been just screaming and hitting the guitar, trying to find something, going crazy. It probably was something like that until he lands on something that sounds like, oh, this has a kind of cadence or a rhythm or
Yeah.
yeah, a pattern.
The note choice is just so it feels almost random sometimes because it's so unpredictable. Like you think a riff or a melody is going a certain way, and then all of a sudden it just goes it completely off note, and it just has this really atonal, like unsettling vibe to it, and it's incredibly effective.
Recently I heard very recently I heard a very good criticism of Blood Incantation and their lack of riffs, and by a very notable mind, by the way. And I would like to contrast it with the fact that Hellhammer is all about riffs, and I think that's what makes it good metal. It's all riff. It's all very and not in the tech death kind of noodly way where you can't remember any of the riffs. No, these are like strong statements and you remember the riff. One of you mentioned the riff, Nick, you mentioned the primitive ridiculous two-note riff, right? But you remember it,
Of
right?
course.
It might be two notes, but it has a rhythm and a
It really does play with the kind of idea of what we think a riff is, but then so many of these riffs are absolutely unforgettable. And I think, it reminds me of kind of like, Iljon, for example, where it's like whoever's the first one to stumble on that riff wins, because any most people have probably come up with something similar because of how simple it is.
It's funny, there's some Darkthrone albums that I think are just a complete carbon copy of this style. Like the stuff written by Nocturnal Culto, especially the stuff that came after Transylvanian Hunger, and the album after that. Some of those albums are just this are just like an attempt to just completely replicate the style. It's just so it sounds so much the same. These riffs are really catchy. There's a lot of really catchy stuff here, and then it's offset by this chaos. There's this great contrasting of chaos and this orderly, like catchy riffs, and it all comes together like just masterfully.
Also, I think it's the fact that they don't go overboard with the number of riffs. Even like on Triumph of Death's 9 minutes. Oh no, I think it's only 7 minutes or so on this version. The songs are generally like they work in pairs of riffs, the very kind of typical, death metal A B A B. Then you might have a quick C and then maybe a D at the end, but it's just A B. And somehow it's despite all the simplicity, it's not obvious where they land, what they're gonna go to. That's what's impressive. It's
That's
they're
what makes it exciting. What am I holding? Anyway, and I like that Hellhammer opens up many philosophical or even practical avenues of discussion with regards to metal. Even though the music is so simple that we can only talk about how catchy it is, how savage it is, and there's a lot bunch of other topics connected with it. Cullen, you said that you heard many other albums that were seemingly copying this approach directly, right? And it's like we constantly miss the point that the fact is that the point is really to a certain extent go wild on your music, like really unhinge your mind. Something's weird's gonna come out, and then you kind of try to organize it, right? But you gotta find that point of rapture for yourself.
Absolutely.
I would highlight For me, there's a band who may not have, maybe it's not as iconic and it's not as solid as Hellhammer and Celtic Frost, but I think they tried to keep playing with the idea of having energy. It was Catharsis, the black metal band. You can't remember any of the riffs either. It's mostly just being wild. But I do like the fact that they are all about being wild and keeping riffs together, right? I don't know if you've heard, if you guys have heard their stuff.
Yeah, I remember you recommended them a long time ago.
A long time ago, yeah. It's mostly for their energy. They even have some, they started out in 1996, and then in still in 2001, 2002, some of their members were experimenting with other sounds in parallel demos, and I think they also mirror that. With regards to Mayhem, who's probably influenced by Hellhammer a lot too, obviously Deathcrush. How did they end up changing their sound afterwards? And did they keep anything, do you think? Did they keep anything from Hellhammer on the Mysteries Dom Satanas?
I think it was there subconsciously. You know, I think it was one of those things where they took the kind of main ideas, the main philosophy, the aesthetics, and then they went with it in their completely own direction.
There's some parts of that album that are very Hellhammer. Like Pagan Fears is a great example. The slower part in Freezing Moon, yeah, it's there. It's definitely there.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely.
You mean stuff that you couldn't trace to any other source but Hellhammer, at least apparently.
Yeah, so Pagan Fears, I mean, I think that's just straight Hellhammer, more or less. That opening part, at least. Those first couple of riffs.
Well, you know, I think this band's like major influence, which is a shame in many ways, that stuck with most people, is the kind of use of a slow, simple riffs. Because if there's one band that has really made a living on Hellhammer and Celtic Frost, it has to be Obituary.
Yeah,
Obituary made their entire sound on this, and I think they were listening to a lot of Hellhammer, and especially I think what's the third? Slowly We Rot is a lot more Hellhammer than it is Celtic Frost.
Definitely.
And then with time they've abandoned that, I think.
Yeah, they play a kind of groovy metal now or something, I don't know.
But it's interesting because all the bands that are you would say is in the vein of Hellhammer or Heart or very Hellhammer influence, there's still so much of Hellhammer doesn't get replicated. Like a good example of this is Beharit. Like a lot of people will say, oh, we're like Beharit or we're influenced by Beharit, and they'll totally the atmospheric stuff and the experimental stuff, and like there's all kinds of stuff on Drowning on the Moon that just didn't end up on any other war metal. It's the same with Hellhammer, where it's like everybody takes these like, you know, atonal power chord riffs and say it's like, oh, this is the Hellhammer stuff, and they completely drop the experimental parts, the weird vocals, the you know, the times where it's just guitar just doing some weird melody that's just going like in a strange direction, and so many elements to these demos and the EP that are just that were just completely lost by all the bands that were, you know, in good faith trying to carry on this style.
Thinking about the drums also going off on their own sometimes, right? Yeah. There are a few bands trying to experiment. There was this, to a certain extent, the band Galicia experiments with wild directions, right? And yeah, there are other, but I think the other bands that I've heard from a few years, like 10 years ago, 5 years ago, that are trying to do this wild approach, trying to use it, they miss the anchors. I mean, Hellhammer has those very memorable riffs, right?
Mm.
But these other bands that try the wild approach, may not have the same memorability. I can't remember the name of the band right now. They were very popular. There still is. It's one guy who keeps doing this different project that are spin-offs of this idea. He's into like pagan stuff and dark paganism. You remember anybody who's doing like wild metal, really aggressive? Doesn't come to mind. Can't remember.
No.
All right. Anyway, you can cut this off if you like. Right. Finally, we have Apocalyptic Rates, originally four songs. And they selected The Third of the Storms, Massacre, Triumph of Death, and Horus, Aggressor. Why do you think they selected these songs, Nick?
Is this the first time that Massacre appears on anything? I think it is. Yeah, so...
Massacre, you're right.
Yeah, well, obviously, we know a great band that took this name. Was Aggressor on any of their other stuff, like Horus Aggressor? I don't think it... No,
I think it's a new song for this.
Yeah, so it's two new songs and two songs that they took from their old stuff. Because, I honestly don't really understand the change here. I think they were so depressed about, you know, everyone kind of, you know, attacking them and everyone kind of putting them down. Like, this is, in reality, it's not even Hellhammer anymore. I really consider this to be proto-Celtic Frost.
It's even slowed down a bit.
Yeah, it's slowed down. I think, you know, Martin Eric Lane added a lot more, you know, order to this kind of music and everything. You know, the only thing that's really wild is, like Cullen said earlier, is the vocals on Triumph of Death on this version, because it generally sounds like a cat dying. But, but, you know, I think a lot of the insanity of a song like Messiah is kind of taken away. We're really getting into a codified style here. I mean, it's still a very good EP, but I think a lot of what made the other stuff so special is beginning to fade, and it's not quite as well organized as Celtic Frost to be on that level. It's a very halfway house between them.
Mm. I would assume that there's some financial and label influence on how this turned out. I mean, this is their first like commercial release. There is probably you know, some influence of the label to get a more like concise sound, possibly. I mean, there's still a lot of experimentation, especially on Triumph of Death. But I can just imagine, given the time when this is when like labels were spending a lot of money on releases, and they really were like influencing how things turned out. Like you said, it could be just like you know, all those bad reviews from the demos catching up to them. It could just be, you know, the reason there's only four songs, I would assume that's just like what they had the budget for. I would assume there's some kind of influence for that. I can't confirm that. It's more just a personal assumption.
It has divided into two sides, right? And what's weird for me is that one of the sides has two songs that are less than 3 minutes long, and the other side is like 14 minutes long.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, which is it's ridiculous. I mean, yeah. Also, this version of A Third of the Storms is it's very smoothed out compared to the previous version. You know, it's a shame. Even though I think the tempos to an extent are a lot more consistent, and the kind of, you know, the looseness of it has gone.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a letdown after all you heard in the demos, right? And then that same year, that's 1984. 1984, we also have Celtic Frost coming out with their first stuff, and they play one of the one of Hellhammer's songs, and I feel like early Celtic Frost kind of is reinfused with energy.
Yeah.
Right. Whereas the last, the Apocalyptic Raids being the last Hellhammer, is, as you say, it sounds like it's lacking energy. It probably comes from disappointment or whatever. And then early Celtic Frost is super energetic. It has its own, like, brewing, boiling fire of ideas, I feel. And it's all put well put together, instead of being all over the place.
Definitely. I mean, Morbid Tales, it just comes out with a bang, definitely, you know.
Yeah. I think there's a, if you can find it, even before Morbid Tales, they have some rehearsals or performances. I don't know if they are actually before Morbid Tales, but I always like to listen to these live takes, because obviously they're much more organic in how they are played, right?
Mm.
Especially bands that are non tech heavy, like they can't reproduce that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I got a question for you guys. Would you? And I know it's only a mini album, but would you consider Apocalyptic Raids to be the first black metal album?
you know, if we could stretch the definition for album that much, I think maybe Satanic Rites would be my choice.
So you would call this the first black metal?
Yeah, I think Satanic Rites is, in its own way, is fully realized black metal.
1983, I think, yes, Satanic Rites. I think it's black metal. I don't think this is thrash. I don't think this is anything else.
I would, in my opinion, I would say no, but, you know, I still think there's a lot of baggage here that ended up being dropped out of what would be considered black metal. You know, the drums weren't really there. You know, a lot of this experimental and doom stuff kind of disappeared. I would accept somebody. There's some albums like where if you were to tell me you think, you know, Venom's the first black metal or Merciful Fate, I would argue heavily against that. Mm-hmm. Someone wanted to make the case for any of these Hellhammer releases, I accept it. I accept that. That's very plausible to me.
I guess you're playing with what do you take as the measure of being black metal, right? I think you're saying, oh, we can be very strict, or we can. Because I feel like this guy, this doesn't fall into thrash metal really either.
Yeah, definitely.
So it's
not.
This kind of weird no man's land where it's not really what we think of as black metal at all.
Yeah.
It's like Death Crush also.
Yeah.
I don't know how to classify Death Crush at all.
Yeah. Yeah, I used to think Death Crush was death metal, but now that I'm a little more experienced, I don't know if I would hold to that opinion today.
Right. I don't think it's death metal either. Have you guys heard a German band called Poison? Not the cheeky, the cheesy thing.
Of course, man. Poison from Germany, classic.
Right. And what are they doing? I mean, some of their stuff in particular, it's not thrash, and it's not black metal, and it's not death metal. It's just this weird underground. That's what I think about when I really think about the term underground metal. I think about Poison and Hellhammer, Death Crush. This is what comes to mind, like the actual non-defined, chaotic, right?
Yeah, that's the thing. Is I think about this. Like when would you consider these the jump to fully have been made for black metal and death metal into what where you could, you know, fully be comfortable with the release being just purely in that style. And I mean, you could make an argument for either genre with these releases. I think you could even make an argument that this is death metal to some extent. I think an argument that it's black metal is a much stronger argument. But yeah, it's still, like you said, it's still in that no man's land. It's still like it's still kind of in both spheres at once, and not in a complete way in either one. It's something I think about a lot, and where I would make that jump. Usually, I chart Bathory's third album. Is that's something I could confidently say, like, this is black metal, period, exclamation point. You know, like, vocals, it's there, the drums there, the riffs definitely there. You know, I don't hear thrash at all. That might be a little bit late for death metal. I would usually say Sepultura's Morbid Visions is, that's very purely death metal, although there's still a lot of thrash there. It's a weird thing. It's an interesting thing. I think about it a lot. And yeah, how I would rank Hellhammer, I would still say it's very much in that proto phase. Like, it's not there just yet, but it's almost there. But again, if you wanted to make the case that this is a death metal album or a black metal album, I wouldn't really argue that. It's an acceptable opinion, I think.
But we can say that the significance of Hellhammer is the rupture, the bringing together of all of the previous styles of metal into something wild and experimental that allowed and minimalistic. It reduced everything to a few components, right? And yeah. How it inspired everything afterwards.
Yeah.
I mean, definitely. You know, I think it's a timeless classic. It's an album that influenced so much. And despite being so simple, you know, not everything about it was used as an influence, which is what makes it so insane.
Yeah, absolutely.
And yeah, just to recap that point, what can present bands learn from Hellhammer? What should we take from it? Since we said we don't want them copying, right? Just copying Hellhammer riffs or even the vocal approach. What should we learn from it?
Just the insanity, just the looseness of it. And yet somehow it still makes sense. It doesn't devolve into noise. It's noisy at times, but it's still there. You know, there's still music there, and you can really hear that music.
Absolutely.
Right. So next episode, we're going to go over Celtic Frost, is more famous and more well established.
Oh, yeah.